It seems like just yesterday that Loudwire wrote about our next guest, Miles Kennedy. He kills it on his acoustic cover of The Trooper, and that's because it was yesterday. They wrote that about you yesterday, by the way. I don't know if you saw it, but thank you so much, Miles, for your time. Appreciate you always.
Oh, thank you so much. It's great to be here.
Thank you. All right, so let's start with the bad news for Alter Bridge and fans of Alter Bridge alike. The band's entire 2020 touring schedule had to be canceled, not a problem unique to the band, obviously. When was the last time you were home for this long, and what effect has rearranging your entire year had on you personally?
Yeah, these are crazy times. I mean, obviously we were excited about getting to tour for the rest of the year. You know, we were pretty early in the Walk the Sky album cycle. I mean, what do you do? These are unprecedented times. And so as far as the effect it's had on me personally, considering it's been the longest I've been home in 11 years. 11
years.
So, I mean, in that sense, I'm not complaining, because I was, you know, 2019, I was on the road or making records. I was gone for a total of over 300 days last year from home. So that was getting challenging.
Yeah.
So to have this entire year to been at home with my family has been amazing. In some ways, that's been the good that's come out of this. But obviously, touring's in my blood. It's in all, you know, the entire band. We're all devastated, just like the entire industry is. I mean, it's and who knows where it's going to end up when it's all said and done, not just with bands, but with venues and promoters and managers and agents. Look, it's grim, but we're just going to have to wait and see what happens.
Yeah, I'm sure the family is loving it. So always a silver lining. I like to look at the half full part of it. Yeah. So on to the good news, though, which is that with your free time, Alter Bridge has put together a new EP titled Walk the Sky 2.0. It'll be out November 6th. And for those who are unfamiliar, Walk the Sky is Alter Bridge's sixth studio album, which they released last year. Walk the Sky 2.0 includes six live songs from that album and a new track called Last Rites, which we're going to talk about. Before we get to the new song, though, what was the process of picking these songs? Is it just a matter of like, all right, let's go with the most popular ones? Or what was the game plan going in?
I think the game plan was to, since we couldn't tour, and we had a record that had just come out, we thought, well, let's take material off the new record that we would have played live that was in the set. And that way fans can get a vibe, get a taste of what it would have been like to have heard it. You know, I guess the best we could do in that sense. So, yeah, we picked the tracks that had already made their way into the set. And we were hoping to play every single song at one point, pepper it throughout the set, because when you have six records to tour on, it gets harder and harder to figure out which tracks will make the cut, especially newer tracks that aren't singles. But so in that sense, it was easy. As far as recording it, we had the multi-tracks running, unbeknownst to many of us. I guess management and our front house guy, they're smart. They know if we tell the guys that we have multi-tracks running during these tours, they're going to get nervous.
Awesome.
And we don't want them to clam up. So just don't tell the kids we're recording this. And so we were thrilled when we found out that there were all these recordings hanging around that we could choose from. So that turned out to be great.
It's got to be better than scouring YouTube for some quality live recordings.
Right?
Yeah. Smart.
Exactly.
So the new song, well, let's frame it this way. So the last rites in Catholicism are the last prayers given to an individual of the faith shortly before death for cleansing of his or her sins before they leave the earth. From what I understand, you have, we'll use the word complicated relationship with religion since your father's passing as a child because he believed that he'd be healed by God and so he didn't see a doctor. So I find it interesting that you named the track Last Rites, aware that your stepfather was a minister as well. So what could you tell us about that name, the song, the lyrical content, how it ties into your life? Basically, give me every single detail about the song.
You asked 3 hours now, I'm just joking. So what I like about being a songwriter is having the opportunity to explore certain concepts and the English language in particular, and a meaning, a word can have such an incredible shift depending on how you spell it. And if you look at the lyrics, you know, it's last rites, R-I-T-E-S, like the way you just explained it. And that would be, there would be that meaning. And then there's rites, R-I-G-H-T-S, and that has a completely different meaning. So I thought it would be interesting, given the state of the world right now and the state of a country, and there are just so many things going on, heavy things, profound things. And so it was taking a step back and looking at all of that and trying to kind of make sense of it, kind of look at things from both sides. Personally, as a lyricist, like there to be a certain amount of ambiguity, mm-hmm. so that it can apply to your own life or to your own perspective. So yeah, it's not a straight up, you know, like the last rites, like the way you mm-hmm. beautifully articulated it. It's not just that. It's also about the idea of, you know, these are my rights. I have the right to do something that I see fit. And then from another perspective of, well, if this is the way you choose to live your life, or if this is the way we choose to do something as a whole, then these could be our quote unquote last rites. Like, this could be the end of this way of life that you're used to. So, you know, I know I'm being somewhat vague and ambiguous on this, but I like to do that so that the listener can then extract their own meaning from it. If I sit there and tell you, well, it's about this, and then that takes all the fun out of it.
No, I totally understand that. You taught guitar and worked at a music store, right? Rock City Music. As we speak, the country's largest retailer of musical instruments might just have to file for bankruptcy. I'm talking about Guitar Center. We all know how much music venues are hurting. God knows how many baby bands, potential superstars, had to get jobs outside of their passion. The list goes on. What keeps you hopeful in a time like this?
The human being has an incredible ability to adapt. I think that's what's keeping my head above water at this point. The paradigm shift is so extreme, no matter how you look at it, and things are changing so quickly mm-hmm. that you can look at the bad, like you just explained what's happening with Guitar Center, because obviously they've become an institution in a sense for those of us who like to buy pieces of gear, and for people who are just getting started, and that's where they go and get their first guitar. I mean, so that's heartbreaking to hear. But with that, what's coming next? How is this going to reshape things? How is it going to reshape how we purchase instruments? How is it going to reshape how we communicate? How is it going to shift how we work from home, or whether we go to an office? You know, there's so many things we're seeing change faster than I've ever seen anything shift. So I'm trying to have faith in human ingenuity and the human's ability to adapt. And I'm trying to keep an optimistic perspective, because yeah, if you step back and really assess the situation right now, it looks pretty damn grim. But we've been in situations like this, I'm sure, many, many times. You know, how did people feel at the advent of World War II? How did people feel, you know, we can just sit there and go through periods in history. We went with the Spanish flu in 1918. So, and we came out of that stronger. So I'm hoping that in 2 years, we'll have the same discussion and we'll go, remember when things seemed so bleak, and look where we are now. And I'm trying to integrate that philosophy through all of this.
Just to follow up, what is the number one shift you've personally experienced? Because you have been, you just completed, and I have a question on that, your second solo album. So what's the number one shift that you're seeing right now for yourself?
The number one shift I'm seeing for myself is the idea of living in sweatpants.
Every day.
Now, but I will say that I actually put on a nice pair of pants. I have pants on right now.
Why?
But you know, it's because it helps put me in the mindset, you know? But I think a lot of people, in fact, I'd be curious to look at, like, on Amazon, how the sales of comfortable, like, sweatpants and whatnot, how that's just gone through the roof. I'm sure it's massive.
I went to the dry cleaners the other day. They're like, where have you been? I'm like, I've been in pajamas. I have no need to come to the dry cleaners, but I hope you guys are
exactly.
Okay. That's funny. Does it take some time for you to go from, like, Alter Bridge mentality to solo mode to a different frame of mind when working on the Slash project? Like, has there ever been a day when you work on multiple music projects? Is it like a light switch for you?
A little bit, but I do prefer to keep everything kind of in its partition. You know, I don't, it's easier if I'm immersed in one of the projects at a time. There was a period, I want to say back in probably around 2012 and 11, when I seem to remember working on Slash stuff and Alter Bridge stuff. And that was getting a little challenging for me because it was just like trying to turn that switch on and off. The drop of the hat wasn't as easy. So yeah, I prefer to stay focused on one. You know, obviously having this entire year at home afforded me the luxury of staying focused solely on the solo project. I didn't say that 1,000 times.
Solely on the solo. You recently shared, after spending the last 7 months writing and recording your second solo album, It's Tracked and In the Can, as they say. What can you tell us about the follow-up to Year of the Tiger? You already shared that it's more of a rock record. You struggled a little bit lyrically. What can you add to that? Something that you haven't already shared.
That's a good question. I mean, I'm trying to keep some element of mystery.
Of course.
but also some of it's going to depend on the songs that are selected for the record, because I did record more than I was going to need so that it could step back and have some perspective and look at what would make the cut. And I think that's going to have a pretty significant shift on the overall vibe of the record. But with that said, I definitely wanted to make sure that there were acoustic elements carried over from Year of the Tiger, so that's not a complete about face. But I wanted to integrate more electric guitar, a lot more solos, a lot more improvising. It's kind of I kind of feel like it's my guitar coming out record in a way. It's something that I wanted to do for a long time. I do love singing. I don't take it for granted, but guitar playing is that's what I spend most of my time doing. As far as from a lyrical standpoint, it was definitely informed by what's going on in the universe right now. It was hard to shut that off. And like yourself, I try to get a lot of information, watch a lot of different news sources, try and gain some perspective outside of the realm that I'm necessarily comfortable with, so that I have an understanding of both sides of a situation and a view. So yeah, I mean, it was something I went deep on. It was something that I really immersed myself in it, because I didn't have to tour. I had nothing going on other than just lots of time to write. So I'm very excited with how it turned out.
You don't have like a release window in mind yet, right? No.
I'm hoping, you know, some of it is depending on how quickly the world gets back to some form of normal. Obviously, that's probably going to be years, but I'm hoping for next year earlier than later. That's my hope, but nothing is set in stone yet.
Right. And speaking of 2021, news also surfaced that a new Slash featuring Miles Kennedy album, Miles Kennedy and the Conspirators record, is coming in 2021. Have you started working on that?
Not officially. You know, Slash is always writing. I'm always writing. And I think that given the state of this pandemic, it's been tricky to figure out how to navigate those waters. If I'm a betting man, I'm going to say that as far as a release goes, 21 is going to be challenging. Obviously, I've got the solo record coming out hopefully next year. So, you know, want to leave an open lane for everything so that there isn't so much music out there where there's just too much to digest. So, you know, that these are wonderful problems to have, where you have the opportunity to make lots of music. And if you're going to do that, you have to make sure that things don't cross paths. So that's about where that stands right now.
So the follow-up to Walk the Sky will be arriving in 2025 at this point, if things...
at this rate, yeah, who knows?
We'll wrap on this one. It's kind of silly, but I like to wrap on silly questions. Going back to your air band years, which I find absolutely fascinating, is there anything you learned while rocking out with no instruments, just you and your friends and guitar rackets? Did anything stick with you to this day? Did it teach you anything?
So I used to come home from school pretty much every single day, and I'd set up a little mirror, grab my tennis racket, and then I graduated up to a piece of plywood cut out in the shape of the guitar, which I still have. There's a gentleman who carved that out for me when I was a kid, and I still have that guitar. One of these days, I think I'll take a picture of
you
that in the next few days and just put it on Instagram. I will do that. And you can even see how much I played on it, because there's like oil, like it's like on the neck where would have been the neck, it's kind of darker because I would, you know, the oil from my fingers just absorbed into it. So yeah, I think what I learned from all of that was a certain amount of what my future rock and roll stance would be. It's like, well, that doesn't look cool. Let's try this. And it was a lot of posing, essentially. It was ridiculous.
Oh, my God. And if there's video, I mean, I don't know if there was, if there is video or images, you can post those along with the actual plywood guitar. That would be fascinating to see.
Okay. I'll try and find something. Maybe I'm sure there's a picture floating around somewhere, too.
Oh, my God. Adorable. All right. Walk This Guy 2.0 arrives November 6th. We will keep you up to date on all of Miles Kennedy's projects. Clearly, a lot of music to come from the artist that we are so thankful shared some of his time with us today. So thank you, Miles, once again.
Always a pleasure, Tony. Thanks for your time.